You can't separate the work of a person from the person. We have to know who this Lynn de Silva is. The first thing about him is that he was really a thorough Christian, deeply rooted in the scriptures. Like a creeper that is well rooted, can travel everywhere without losing the sap of life. He was deeply Christian, thoroughly Christian, and deeply rooted in the Word of God. And I remember when I was discussing something with him, his wife Lakshmi was also sitting, and I saw something. I remember I mentioned a text we were discussing, and suddenly Lakshmi went to the room, brought back the Hebrew Bible, opened the text, and read in Hebrew that text. So the thing is, what I noticed was that he had a wife who was also deeply rooted in the scripture. This very few people know. Lakshmi was an inspiration behind him. Lynn had someone to discuss scriptures with. So there was a dialogue between the couple on the Word of God. This is the first thing I like to mention, that you shouldn't enter into dialogue without being rooted in your religion properly. Secondly, Lynn and Lakshmi were such a pair. It was not a pair, it was one person. It was an inseparable pair, that they worked together, and that the inspiration was a covenantal love. And therefore, a man who experienced love and man who experienced God in that love. These are two things that I felt was defined the person called Lynn. Third one is his extraordinary humility. At that time, 66, I had just come after theology in Naples and after Vatican II and started my doctorate in the University of Sri Lanka, Vidyodaya campus. And it was the first time that a Catholic priest started this kind of thing, and he heard about it. And actually, he came in search of me, and we clicked. I don't know how we clicked. He practically non-verbally invited me to work with him. So, and I joined him at that 1966, joined him and started working with the dialogue, the new issue, and so on, and still continue his work. So his humility, it is I who should have gone and visited him. He was in the field for years before me, and yet he came in search of me. There was this mutual trust between us, and we thought together. So these are three things that define the person. And this is the person who did so much of work in the field of interreligious dialogue. I must say that two things about the preparation of the person called Lynn de Silva for this work. First, you must remember that Basil Jackson was the man who prepared the ground for him, because Methodist Church had a reputation for being polemical rather than dialogical. And people like Gogoli, you know, Copplestone and David Silva were debating, challenging Buddhists. Here, Lynn was the first to start dialogue, and the preparation was made by Basil Jackson. In 1953, he started the Center for Religion and Society, CRS, Lynn baptized into Ecumenical Institute for Study and Dialogue. Now, the Methodist Church entirely took a new turn, and it was leading the other churches under Basil Jackson. It was a study center, they were going for peripheral studies, they were going to the frontiers of the church, and working with those outside the church, and therefore already the ground was laid for Lynn de Silva to start this new work in a new way, of course, in a new way. So that must be told, that that there was a precursor. There was a British Methodist pastor who prepared the ground. And Lynn de Silva owes much to him, and we all owe to him, because Methodist Church is a third that led all the other churches into this new direction. Then when Lynn de Silva's contribution should be defined, as I have done in many places, as apologetical in the Greco-patristic understanding of the term, apologetical, not polemical, because Methodist Church was polemical in its approach. Apologetical, not in the sense of defensiveness, but in the way the Greek fathers understood the word. They were telling the non-Christians, look, we appreciate your past and your achievements, and they don't clash much with what we say, so please join us in this journey. We are not attacking you, we are not destroying you, but we are in one way joining you. So this kind of apologetics, which was the type of apologetics that the Buddhists were practicing at that time. Kain Jayatilika, Jayavikrama, all these people of the Peradeniya school was having this apologetical approach. Buddhism is not what you think. It is a respectable philosophy. It is modern. It can dialogue with science and so on. And asking Christians to understand Buddhism differently. That kind of apologetics of the Buddhists met Lynn's apologetics in presenting Christianity to Buddhists. This is the atmosphere in which Lynn's work has to be assessed. Of course, in one instance it became polemical because somebody was polemical. That was the way he criticized and practically destroyed the doctoral dissertation of Professor Dharmasi, Gunapala Dharmasi. Here we see Lynn started on a point. This is very interesting, how Lynn answered Dharmasiri. Dharmasiri said, there is no soul, therefore no God. It's the concept of the soul that ultimately ends up in immortal soul, that ends up in presenting or arguing for an eternal divinity. Lynn de Silva very cleverly said, you say no soul, therefore no God. I say no soul, therefore God. That was the only moment where he was polemical, in response to a polemical thing. There he also brought out a gist of what he would later write in his classic, The Problem of the Self in Buddhism and Christianity. It's really a classic. Christian theology took a new turn entirely in response to Buddhism. So he showed that creation, which is anatta, anicca, dukkha, calls for a permanent reality. That was the only, it was a kind of a, it looks polemical, but it was apologetical in showing in the light of the book that Dharmasiri wrote, kind of a restatement of Christianity, which also corrects Christians in reading the Bible. So it was a double barrel work. On one side he was shooting the conservative Christians, in the other he was shooting down the Dharmasiri type of polemical Buddhists. That is his intellectual work. And the place, his place was his library, and his little center was crowded with people. And great intellectuals met there. K.N. Jayatilaka and Neville Gunaratna, Nihal Pereira, these are all great Buddhist scholars. And I met them thanks to Lynn. Actually, Lynn is the one who prepared the ground for me. He's really a pioneer and really a fresh, a new, novel thinker in interreligious dialogue. Then another thing that he brought out, and Buddhists were very grateful to him, that he brought out what I called cosmic religiosity, what he called popular Buddhism. This was something that was not brought into the dialogue, that there is a popular form of Buddhism. It was Lynn who pioneered this this approach to popular, how the people interpret a religion and people's religion, which should not be, because the people also bring a new dimension which sometimes the scholars fail. So while being an intellectual giant, going through these texts, a self-trained Pali scholar, studied his Pali alone and mastered it, really mastered it. And his textbooks, both his textbooks, Problem of the Self in Buddhism and Christianity, and the other one is Buddhism, Beliefs and Practices, are useful to many Buddhists. And I know many Buddhists who confess to me that Lynn's book, both books, had helped them to understand their own religion at depth. So I think the person that comes out in all this thing, is in this work, is a person rooted in his religion, convinced, but with an intellectual honesty that made him delve into the other religion to its depth and to make sure that it does not distort the other religion. A kind of a breakthrough in the Methodist tradition. It was a breakthrough, complete breakthrough.